Hello, appraisers. This is Brandon with Spark for Appraisers, and we are going to continue in our video series showing different methods of coming up with adjustment support. And we're going to also continue with different types of regression. So far, we have covered ordinary least squares and also Thiel-Senn. Both of those are forms of simple regression. And by simple regression, all we're meaning basically is that we are not teasing out multiple variables at the same time. So far we've been showing how we can extract possibly a GLA adjustment or a lot size adjustment or a time adjustment, but not multiple at the same time. So that would be multiple regression. It is much more complicated, and so far we're not going to be covering that. The method that we're going to cover today is called least absolute deviation. Let me go ahead and see if I can not do a horrible job of just writing that up here. So that's least absolute deviation. Okay, and again, it's another type of simple regression. And we're going to have our independent variable down here on the x-axis, as always, which in this case we're talking about GLA. Could be lot size, bedrooms, bathrooms, quality, condition, whatever. And on the y-axis, our dependent variable is sale price. Okay, so if you'll remember with Thiel-Senn regression, what we did was we took every pair of points possible and we drew a line through them. So just as an example here, we do something like that. And then we would go and do the same thing with the next set of points. So I would go like this and draw through those two points. And then I would do the same thing and I would draw through the next set of points. So I would start here and go to here until every single pair of points had a line drawn through it. And then we would calculate the slope of every single one of those lines and then we would get the median of all of those, and that would be the result using Thiel-Senn regression. Now, least absolute deviation works somewhat similar in the sense that we are eventually going to be drawing a line through every single pair of points that's possible, but in addition to that, we have to do quite a bit more math. So let me show you how it works. So let's just take one example. So in the beginning, let's just pick an easy pair here. So let's choose this. So those two points that were right here and here. And now what we need to do at this point is we need to calculate the residual. And so if you'll remember from the first video, the residual is the difference between the actual sale price. In this case, we're talking about the dependent variable, which in this case is sale price. So it's the difference between the actual sale price and the predicted sale price. And so I'm going to just draw a line right here. It's actual minus, whoops, to predicted, and then actual to predicted. And so in this case, we only have four data points, two that were used to draw the line, and then two where we calculate the residuals. So we do the math there, and now we get those numbers. So in this case, this minus this, let's just ballpark it at that's $40,000. And then this one, that's quite a bit more. Let's ballpark that at negative 80,000. Because this number is below the line. So this minus this would give us a negative number. Then we take the absolute value of each of those. And so that, of course, gives us 40,000 and 80,000. And notice absolute value, and we got absolute deviation in here. So you can kind of see where the name comes from. And then what you do is you just add those up. So we have 120,000. That is the result from those two pairs. You basically draw the line, you calculate the formula for that line. And when I say formula, I'm talking about y equals mx plus b. You calculate that for that line. Then you plug in the x value and you get what the y is, the predicted. And then you subtract the actual from the predicted and the actual from the predicted for every other data point that's on there. And so in the end, we get 120,000. Now let's back up a little bit here. I'm just gonna try and remove some of that. Okay, and now we go in here and we draw the next line. So we pick a point, we draw through it, and now we have to calculate the residuals from this point. If you'll remember, there was a point here, so we calculate the residual of that one. Where was it? I think it was up here, down to there, and then this down to there. And so just ballparking that, that looks like maybe 75,000 and 75,000, just guessing. We add those together. First, we take the absolute value of each of them, which in this case is the same number, and then that gives us 150,000 when we add it together. If you'll remember, before we had 120,000. So 120,000 is still our best number because you can see it's called least absolute deviation. So we need to focus on the lowest number after adding them all up. So far we're still at 120,000, which was this line right here between these two points. And so then what we would do is we draw the next line. So we draw a line from here up to here, and then calculate the residuals for those, take the absolute value, add them up, get our number. Then we do it from this point to this point, and then this point to this point, and then this point to this point, until we've done it with every potential pair, just like you would with Thiel-Senn. But the difference here is with Thiel-Senn, you just calculate the slope of every single line. But here, we not only have to calculate the slope of every line and get the formula, the y equals mx plus b of every one of those lines, then we have to plug in the remaining points and figure out the actual minus the predicted for every one of those points, take the absolute value, add them all up, and then we do all that, and in the end, we pick the number that is the lowest, and that is the answer, essentially, using least absolute deviation. So whatever that line that resulted in the lowest number is, that y equals mx plus b is basically our result from least absolute deviation. So in that case, it would give us something, just ballparking it here, something like 60x plus, and I'm just making up numbers, 80,000. And so what's important here, at least in getting adjustment support, is the 60. That is the number that could potentially be our adjustment for GLA. And so that's the way least absolute deviation works. You essentially go through every single pair of points, you draw a line, you calculate the residuals, you get the absolute value of all of those, you add them all up, and you get a result. And then in the end, you do that for every single pair of points, and you take the one that gave you the lowest number, thus least absolute deviation, and that one is your result. Okay, so now I'm going to switch over to our Excel sheet just to kind of show you here. So just to give you an idea, when we calculated Thiel-Senn on all of these properties, essentially we figured out that there was, I think when we had that extra set of data in here, which was 3,000 and 300,000 in our previous video, we realized that that resulted in us having, it was 28 points of data, or 28 calculations that we had to do in order to get those 28 different slopes. And then once we got those 28 slopes, we just take the median of all those. That's how Thiel-Senn worked. Now, with least absolute deviation, because there is so much more going on, there are a lot more calculations. And so that is sort of the point of a tool like our adjustment calculator, is don't waste all your time just doing these menial calculations, because you could see none of it is difficult math. It's all pretty straightforward and simple. It's just that there's so much of it. So in this case, we would take our first pair, and then we would calculate the residuals. So you can see there's, in this case, we have eight properties. So we take a pair, that leaves us with six remaining properties. So then we have to calculate the residuals for those six, for each of those other six dots or six data points. And then we take the absolute value, then we add them all up. Then we take the next line and there's six remaining data points. We take the residuals of those, absolute value, add them all up. And then the next one, and then the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and so on, until every single one of these, we've calculated all the residuals on all of those, taken the absolute value of all of those and added them all up. So this one that had essentially maybe 28 calculations when we were talking about Thiel-Senn, and keep in mind, this is just for eight properties. It had 28 calculations for Thiel-Senn. When we're talking about least absolute deviation, that same 28 is actually 729. That's this number right here. And we did the math, and even if you just have, let's say you have 15 properties, 15 properties results in 6,961 calculations to come up with the correct result. So 15 properties is nearly 7,000 different calculations that have to be done. Again, just to illustrate the point of a tool like this, again, you don't have to use our adjustment tool, but a tool like this or figuring it all out and doing it yourself in Excel is essential in crunching data like this rather than you hand doing it every single time. So again, that's how least absolute deviation works, somewhat similar to Thiel-Senn, but with a lot of extra calculations added on top. And one more thing to quickly note is that least absolute deviation is also considered to be robust to outliers, just like Thiel-Senn is. Okay, that's it. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you again in the next one.